Hey guys, it's Pastor Sean here. I pray that this sermon, this resource, would work in conjunction with you being a part of a local church as God grows you as a disciple of Jesus. If this resource blesses you, would you consider giving back to us at River Oaks by giving online with the link below so that we can continue to saturate Greater Murfreesboro with the love of Jesus Christ? Well, good morning, church. How we doing? Yeah, you ready to get after it?
Yeah.
Amen to that. Well, everybody loves a good comeback story, don't they? Exhibit A, Atlanta Braves last night, twice having to come back from six runs. If you saw that incredible thing they did to win that, I was half asleep, half awake through the process as my wife was watching. But incredible to see that. And today we start a series on Jonah where we get to see a comeback story that's incredible. Just incredible. And it's the comeback story of a city named Nineveh. And I'm not talking about a comeback as in economically, I'm talking about a comeback as spiritually, being renewed. God showing up and doing something that only God can do. I love the story of Jonah throughout scripture, and maybe it was the flannel graphs I grew up with as a kid at church that I love so much. It's nostalgic, so to speak, but we love the huge nature of the story and what it carries, and my prayer for us is in the next 4 weeks is that we'll learn a deeper level of seeing ourselves in the story of Jonah and what God would display for you and I as we walk and follow the Lord together. Now, if you've never read a whole book all the way through, Jonah's a great place to start. It's short, and which makes it easily accessible. But on top of that, it's written as a narrative as well, so it's easy to read and understand what's actually taking place. I think you'll enjoy that aspect of it. But God wants to ultimately equip you as followers and disciples of Jesus Christ to be able to carry the gospel of Jesus in everywhere that you go. That's the goal that God has for you as you sit in his presence as disciples of Jesus Christ to share that with someone else. And what we'll see through the story of Jonah is that there's kind of like a 30,000 foot view thought that God is going to expand upon through all of these chapters that he has for you and I. And the thought is in the form of a question, and this question is this: what does it look like to be an extension of God's mercy? Because God wants to use us for his gospel to share it with the people around us, to know Jesus Christ, you're called to be an extension, a vessel of God's mercy to the people around you. And Jonah gives us a picture into how difficult that can sometimes be. Ask yourself, what level of mercy do I demonstrate to those around me? Show me a merciless person, and I'll show you someone that has forgotten, has spiritual amnesia, so to speak, forgotten the forgiveness that God has extended to them. See, it's out of the mercy that God has given to each and every one of us through Jesus Christ alone that mercy takes root and grows inside of our own hearts for others around us. See, our level of mercy grows as our following of Jesus Christ grows hand in hand with it. And the beautiful nature of what we're going to see in the next 4 weeks is this thought about Jonah, that Jonah needed Nineveh as much as Nineveh needed Jonah. Many of us know this story, and it's all about what Jonah's going to go do in Nineveh, but the reality is Jonah needed it just as much. And we'll see the beauty of that through the story. It's a story about rebellion and revival, a reluctant prophet of Jesus who's called to serve God but only wants to serve himself. Kind of sometimes how we live. And today we'll look at Jonah's rebellion and sin in chapter 1 specifically. And we're probably going to see our story play out inside of it as well. So if you have your Bibles, go ahead and grab them. We're turning to Jonah. Get out your devices. That's where we'll be. If you're a guest with us, no worries. We'll have it behind our screen, behind me on the screen as well. If you don't know where it is in the Bible, it's right between Obadiah and Micah. That probably didn't help, did it? Jonah, I love this, is tucked kind of in there with those books that sound like Star Wars characters, right? Obadiah, Obi-Wan, Jonah, Jabba, Micah, Chewbacca, Nahum. My fellow Star Wars geeks, we're there. Amen. If you can't find it, use the table of contents. No shame. But it will be on the screen behind me as well. So Jonah chapter 1, we'll be starting in verse 1 as we get after it together. So let's dive into Jonah, no pun intended, as well. All day. Get ready. I'm kidding. Right as we jump in right here, Jonah chapter 1, verse 1 through 16, we're going to see one overarching thought that I think God has for us specifically on this portion of the story that we'll take away today. And that thought is this: we can't outrun, or you can't outrun your sin or God. You can't outrun your sin or God. We're going to see that play out. Chapter 1, verse 1, I'll read. You can follow along. The word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai. Go to the great city of Nineveh. Now we have to stop already. Let's just stop right there because we have to ask an important question even as we get into the narrative of the story. And the question is this true? Did this actually happen? See, I think for the majority of us, this story is well known. We know about a big fish, maybe a whale that swallowed Jonah. We get that. But for most people, they get to that part of the story and they immediately dismiss it. Ah, it's never happened. Okay. But if you ask me, I don't even know that that's a top 10 hard thing to believe inside of Scripture. Like, I don't think it's there. Let me give you five things I think are harder to even believe. Genesis chapter 1, God spoke the world in creation just by the speaking of his voice. Crazy. Exodus 7 talks about the plagues of Egypt. Water being turned to blood. Locusts, frogs, like all that's hard to believe. Matthew chapter 1, verse 18, Mary gets pregnant as a virgin through the Holy Spirit. A little bit harder to believe. Luke chapter 2, God born as a baby who heals the sick, raises the dead, is crucified, and comes back to life, defeating death. John chapter 11, Jesus resurrects Lazarus who has been dead for 3 days. We know those are true. This is not hard to believe that a fish swallowed a man. Go turn on the news. Happens in Florida. They don't get them whole, but they get them. I debated sharing that. I shouldn't have. I immediately regret it. Shame on me. Here's the question that really matters as we resolve this. Is there a God that is intimately involved inside of our lives? Yes. Did he send his son, Jesus Christ, to die for you and I? Yes. Knowing and believing in that truth means we can believe what we're about to read as truth. This is truth. This is God's word spoken truly. Now, some of you are sitting in the room skeptical going, man, that's not enough. Okay, sure. Let's go a little bit deeper. How do we know this is true? Well, the names, the dates, the details are biblically factual and historically factual. Meaning this, it says Jonah, the son of Amittai, like he had a dad. It didn't say once upon a time there was a man named Job, right? Like we can look at actual history. We know that in 2 Kings, we can look at that and refer to that Nineveh Nineveh actually existed. It was a city that was there. We know that through the Dead Sea Scrolls that were found historically. We know that is accurate. We can look at it and see the truth that in 2 Kings, Jonah was also commissioned by God to go carry out different things as a prophet. We can look at Jesus Christ, his words that are accounted for in the New Testament as well. Jesus said this when it came to Jonah in Matthew chapter 12, verse 39. Listen, a wicked and adulterous generation asks for a sign, but none will be given it except the sign of the prophet Jonah. For as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of a huge fish, so the Son of Man will be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. The men of Nineveh will stand up at the judgment with this generation and condemn it, for they represented it at the preaching of Jonah. And now something greater than Jonah is here. See, Jesus himself refers to this story as truth. Many of us will dismiss this and go, well, Jesus taught in parables. This is clearly just a parable. It's just a story. that he's illustrating. No, not at all. Jesus points to the truth. This actually happens. Maybe you're not a follower of Jesus Christ and you're going, well, listen, how do I still know it's true? Well, listen, go look at history. Jesus is a man that walked this earth that has proven he was one of the greatest rabbis ever. We know him as the greatest, but in Jewish culture, regarded as one of the greatest. The greatest rabbi in the history of Jewish culture said this was true. Go there. We know this is a historical account, a fact of something that took place as we read. So let me remind you, this is not just a story about a big magical fish swallowing a guy. This is a story about God. And our obsession on this fish can cause us to miss what's actually transpiring inside of the person of Jonah. Warren Wiersbe says it this way. We get so obsessed with what was going on in the whale that we miss seeing the drama going on inside of Jonah. Do not miss that here today. Look at the centerpiece of Jonah and what God's about to do inside of his heart. Let's take a journey together. Verse 2. Go to the great city of Nineveh and preach against it because its wickedness has come up before me. Now, Nineveh, let's pause right there. What is Nineveh? Nineveh was a great city. It was the capital city of the Assyrian Empire, which at the time was the most prominent and powerful empire on earth. Jonah chapter 3, verse 3 will tell you that it took him 3 days. It would take you 3 days to walk across the entirety of the city. Massive. It was a city that would have been known simply by its name, like New York, London, Tokyo. You would just say the name and you would immediately know what people were talking about. It was a prominent city. For those of you that love Batman, it's Gotham. It's the equivalent of Gotham is what this is. A great city given over to great sin. Man, they loved their sin. It was filled with idolatry, greed, lust, murder, all the wickedness of the human heart that you could possibly imagine. The Ninevites were known as the cruelest people in the ancient world, and they prided themselves inside of this. For example, this is what they would do. When they conquered someone, a nation, a people, they would dig a hole inside of the sand and put the person in the hole and bury them up to their neck. They would pull out their tongue and put a pike right through their tongue into the ground so that it was outstretched so they would die from starvation and bleeding out as a reminder that you do not mess with us. If that wasn't bad enough, as they're sitting there in the middle of the night, they would play NSYNC on repeat and make them listen to his torch. I'm just kidding. It was just too gruesome. I had to lift this back up. We're good. Okay. The point is, they were the type of people that said, listen, don't mess with us. You don't want nothing to do with us. We conquer and we put people to shame. Now, what we don't know and what you need to know is that Nineveh's primary enemy, who they like to pick on, so to speak, was the nation right to the south, Israel, the Jews. Jonah knew all too well as a Hebrew how bad the Ninevites were. Let me say it this way. The Ninevites hated Jonah. Jonah hated the Ninevites. And this is the setting for what's about to take place. God sent Jonah to speak out against his worst enemy, the people who hated him the most, Jonah had to go speak to. So before you judge Jonah for what's about to be said, Jonah had a great deal of personal bitterness against these people. Verse 3, but Jonah ran away from the Lord and headed for Tarshish. Now don't miss this. Jonah fled God's presence out of fear. But he was not fearful of the Ninevites and what they would do to him. He was fearful that if he went and did what God asked him to do and preached, that they would repent and God wouldn't punish them. He hated them. Jonah wanted to see the wrath of God destroy that nation for what they had done. But here's what we have to understand. Becoming an extension of mercy means we need to love those we don't like. This is what God's doing in Jonah's heart. He's reminding Jonah, he's going, no, Jonah, you don't understand. I love the Ninevites just as much as I love you. Go. Preach against them. Jonah didn't want to see it. God's working on his heart. Verse 3, but Jonah ran away from the Lord and headed for Tarshish. He went down to Joppa, where he found a ship bound for that port. He shows up and there's a ship already ready. All he has to do is pay the fare to go. After paying the fare, he went aboard and sailed for Tarshish to flee from the Lord. Two things we need to see immediately right there. Sin is always going to cost you one way or another. He had to pay to get on a boat, pay that fare to go away from the Lord, to walk in his disobedience. He would have to pay for it. Second thing we need to see inside of that is this. There will always be a ship ready for Tarshish when you're trying to evade God. Here's what I mean. There will always be something or someone or somewhere to run to get away from God. Jonah found a ship ready. Have you ever noticed that people will use the language of, well, it was there, it was ready, as a way to escape what they're called to go do? Know this. The ready way is not always the right way. It's not always the right way. Man, you may see people living in sin or secret sin, or you may be living it thinking, man, everything's going great. I don't know what you're talking about. Just wait. The ready way is not always the right way. If you want to run from God, there will always be a ship ready, waiting for you to get there. Here's why. We have an enemy named Satan. Satan's role is to ready the ship for your disobedience. His role is to make sure, man, it's ready to go. Jump on. Let's get out of here. Here's what I mean. If you have wandering eyes, there's always going to be someone to flirt with. If you chase greed, there will always be a great deal or something to buy. If you want out of God, a God-given calling, there will always be a new opportunity or a new job waiting for you. If you want to quit, there will always be someone who agrees with you and tells you to do it. If you want to disobey your parents, there will always be someone that'll support you in it. If you want to cheat on a test, there will always be a way to do it. See, this is the beginning of Jonah's rebellion against God. God clearly told him to go, and he ran the other way. Write this down. Rebellion is simply saying no to God. Sin is the intentional decision to go away from God. See, we tend to evaluate our walk with God by comparing ourselves to others, right? Well, I go to church more than they do. I'm doing pretty good. I think I know the Bible pretty well. I think I'm doing all right. Like, I'm a pretty moral person. I make the right choice more often than they do. And we compare ourselves to one another based on our spirituality. But the reality is, what demonstrates great maturity is the last obedience you've had with God when he asked you to do something. That you're walking so intimately with him that you hear his voice, you know his voice, and you're obedient to whatever he asks. It was a few years ago. I was in a Kroger down in Georgia, and financially, as a family, we were doing pretty good, and we had enough, and we didn't have excess, but we had enough, and I was at the grocery store, and I remember being in the checkout line, and God does this every once in a while, but there's a lady behind me that God pressed on me as I'm checking out, pay for her groceries. Just pay for her groceries. I thought to myself, let me tell you why that's a bad idea, God. Like, this, one, that's going to affect our budget. Not a good place to go. Let's not, like, I don't, like, I spend that money, there's going to be a problem down the line. Not going to be all right. And just had this conversation with God where I could just justify everything and every reason why I wouldn't do this. And I didn't blatantly go, no, God, I'm not. I just kind of dismissed it. I ate something bad yesterday and I'm just crazy in my mind right now, whatever. And I'm not doing it. And I didn't. Can I tell you, man, I've had more instances like this than just this, but it haunted me. And haunted is a relative term. I would try to read the word of God or sit down with God and pray and talk, and it's like there's nothing there. Scripture tells us that you can grieve the Holy Spirit, be so disobedient. That's not that God that pulls back. It's you just can't, you're not in tune, you can't hear because there's sin that has separated you now and needs to be confessed and confronted. And I just remember that in that moment, and I remember thinking to myself, all right, God, I'm sorry. Talk to me. And we do that all the time, and I think God realizes we're not really sorry, we're just sorry we got caught, and we're sitting in this moment. And I can admit, in those moments, it takes me a lot longer to actually get to the place where I'm actually sorry for what I did or didn't do. And God, when God speaks into your life, and it's clear, and you understand that you have a calling to go do something, even as small as that, how are you responding? Where are you right now telling God no? Maybe it's not a blatant no. Maybe it's just a dismissal of what you think the Holy Spirit is leading you towards. Where are you dismissing that? God's going, come on. I got something for you. I got a calling for you. Don't dismiss that. Maybe for you, it's a relationship that you know isn't pleasing to God, but you won't leave it or quit. Maybe it's a sacrifice God has put on your heart to make maybe money or serving or your time. Maybe it's a sin you need to confess. Maybe it's a sacrifice of your time for somebody else's sake rather than yours. Maybe it's to go. God has called you, given you a mission to go and do something for the kingdom of God, and you're just dismissing it. Can I tell you from experience? Man, you're never further from God than when you're close to him and you say no. Oh. Now the beauty of that is when we confess it and repent, Christ is so quick to forgive and restore that your sins are as far as the east is from the west. I love that. Feels really heavy in the room, so let me lift this up real quick. Just so we understand what Jonah really did, you have to see geographically on a map the decision that he made. Let me show you behind me what just took place. Literally, he's at Joppa on a port. God's asked him to go 500 miles to the east/north to Nineveh, and he gets and pays a fare to get on a boat to go 2,500 miles the opposite direction. Isn't that ridiculous? And it looks so ridiculous, but when you look at it, you finally go, oh man, I get it. All right, he's out of here. He's like, nope, I'm not doing it. But we do this all the time. We do this all the time. Now, I think God sometimes in our lives goes, man, I want you to forgive that person, restore that relationship, extend forgiveness, accept forgiveness. Let me restore what is broken. Go 500 miles in this direction for that relationship. And we're like, I'm going 2,500 miles that direction, not to. That's what Jonah's doing. That's what rebellion is. God just allowed us to have a picture to put it to words. We do this all the time. Verse 4. Then the Lord sent a great wind on the sea, and such a violent storm arose that the ship threatened to break up. All the sailors were afraid, and each cried out to his own God. And they threw the cargo into the sea to lighten the ship. Now, I just love this. Not for their sake, but for ours. I love the fact that the problem with running from God is that God is already where you're going. Like, I'm going to run as far and as fast as I possibly can away from God. The problem is he's right there when you get there, just waiting. And here's the situation. These sailors are scared out of their mind. They're like, dude, you got a God that we can pray to? Pray to him right now. Throw everything off this ship. We're going under. This is crazy, man. Somebody do something. They get out their crystal balls, their tarot cards, their magic eight balls, their TV evangelists. They start rubbing them and asking. And they're like, how do we get out of this in this moment? And yet, look at verse 5b. But Jonah had gone down below deck where he lay down and fell into a deep sleep. Man, I have always wondered every time I read this, how in the world is this man sleeping in the middle of this storm? How many of you are like light sleepers? Like you wake up really easily. Anybody in the room willing to admit light sleeper? Okay, a lot of us. How many of you are heavy sleepers? It's like, forget it. I'm out. See you later. We don't like you very much when we're light sleepers. But there's always something that happens in sleep. If you're a parent, you have kids, there's always this moment that I love talking about that always happens inevitably inside of sleeping. And it usually happens from 2 a.m. to 4 a.m. And what happens is one of the kids opens the door or walks into the room and creaks and makes a noise. And in that moment, you try to hold as still as you possibly can to not let you know your husband or wife that you're sleeping. Because the first person that moves is getting up. You've never done that. I know. I know. Me neither. Happens all the time. I love in this moment that we see through God's word that Jonah, despite all of this, is out cold sleeping. These sailors are on the boat deck crying out to false gods. And the ironic nature is that the prophet of God, chosen by him to bring the word of God, is asleep. What is God trying to show us in this? What is he trying to show us? Well, we know that God's word is written in different ways based on the book of the Bible that it is. I mean, Psalms, we know is kind of like poetry. It's this beautiful writing. We look at Proverbs and we see this like leadership intensive sayings, almost like a father written to a son as it was. But we can look at the book of Jonah and you need to know that it's written as an allegory. As it tells a narrative story, the words have significant meaning and they play on one another as they go. So if you're paying attention, there's a play on words happening. Jonah is full of this stuff. And the ones that we're seeing right now is the word down. Go home and reread this and look for the word down in your translation. Jonah goes down to Joppa, down to the inner part of the ship, down into a deep sleep. What God is trying to show us is this downward progression of sin that takes place when we're rebellious. Pastor Warren Wiersbe says it this way: God is giving us a picture of the downward progression of sin. It starts with a small disobedience. It ends in a total spiritual disaster where we are spiritually asleep in a world that needs us to be awake. See, the sailors desperately needed Jonah, the prophet of God, as they're crying out to these false gods going, what is going on? He's sleeping. Church, hear this. Do not miss this. If you are a disciple of Jesus Christ, you know the truth of the gospel. Are you asleep with that? Or are you sharing the truth with everyone around you? There are people that are caught in storms in their life around you, struggling through things and going through hardships, and they're crying out to anything and everything, these false gods of the world, our culture, anything that'll listen, and you have the truth. Are you sharing that? See, God has called us, as disciples of Jesus Christ, put us on the front line to be engaged in this war that is taking place. I love the way that C.T. Studd says it. He's a missionary. Let me read it for you. He says this: some want to live within the sound of a church or a chapel bell. I want to run a rescue shop within a yard of hell. I love it. Typical missionary, going and getting it. Man, we need more studs in the church is what we need, right? Here's the reality. Our rebellion and disobedience is sin, and it affects others. Don't miss what's taking place right here. Because of Jonah's sin and disobedience, all the sailors were suffering. Our sin is never isolated. You may think it's private, but it is affecting the people around you more than you could ever know. Here's why. Your sin can make you an unfaithful spouse, untrustworthy person, disappointing friend, bad teammate, a coworker that's constantly using people, make you a high maintenance type of person where you're just constantly pulling from other people. The greatest gift you can give to anyone as a disciple of Jesus Christ, to your spouse, your kids, your coworkers, and your neighbors, your teammates, and your friends, is to walk closely with Jesus Christ in obedience, listening to his voice as he leads you to love the people around you, to be a vessel of mercy to everyone. It's like when you're flying on a plane. Ever travel on a plane, what they always tell you, if the mask drops down, whose mask, oxygen mask, are you supposed to put on first? Yours, right? Not my intention. If that happened to me, I'd be like, put it on my kids, like next to me, but you can't do that if you're like you can't do it. You gotta take care of yourself first. Listen, spiritually speaking, you have to take care of yourself first. Do you understand that? You can't help save anybody around you. First of all, you can't change their heart. God can use you to be a gateway to point back to Jesus Christ, but you can't change a heart. But the only way he can use you to change a heart himself is if you're spiritually walking with him healthy. He's going to use that intentionally. And yeah, I say that, and we're going to say something beautiful that God does despite Jonah's disobedience. It's a cool thing. But are you spiritually awakened to what God has called you? Did you see our failure to walk with God has eternal devastating consequences for those around us? The sailors' lives are at risk because of Jonah's disobedience. And so we see that becoming an extension of mercy means we see and grasp the depths of our own sin. We have to know that. Verse 6, the captain went to him and said, how can you sleep? Get up and call on your God. Maybe he will take notice of us so that we will not perish. Then the sailors said to each other, "Come, let us cast lots to find out who is responsible for this calamity." They cast lots, and the lot fell on Jonah. In other words, they spin the roulette wheel again and again every time it landed on Jonah. I'm like, all right, it's this guy. Verse 8. So they asked him, "Tell us, who is responsible for making all this trouble for us? What kind of work do you do? Where do you come from? What is your country? From what people are you?" He answered, "I am a Hebrew and I worship the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the seas and the dry land." This terrified them, and they asked, "What have you done?" See, they knew he was running away from God, from Lord, because he had already told them so. See, sometimes God sends storms into life because of our own sin, but sometimes it's because of somebody else's sin that's around us, that's taking place. But the beauty of this, when we see this in the story, is God's gonna let you know. They spin the wheel. It's Jonah. God let him know. It's him. Like, you want to go after him. Man, you got a storm going on in your life? Ask God. Sit in the presence of God and go, "God, why is this happening?" I promise you, if it's a result of your own sin, the Holy Spirit will point you right at it. Because God wants us to know. Listen, when I discipline my kids, I don't yell at them and throw them in the corner when they say, "Why?" I go, "You know why," and just leave them there. I don't do that. I get down on their level. I go, "Listen, let me tell you what you just did, how that affected you and them and what's going on. And that's not okay. It's hurting things." And I explain it. God is the same way. He loves us. We're his children. He's going to get down on our level and help us to see what's taking place. If it's a result of sin, the Holy Spirit will direct us straight to it. Verse 11, the sea was getting rougher and rougher. So they asked him, "What should we do to you to make the sea calm down for us?" "Pick me up and throw me into the sea," he replied. I can't believe he said that. "And it will be calm. I know that it is my fault that this great storm has come upon you." Instead, the men did their best to row back to land, but they could not, for the sea grew even wilder than before. Props to the pagan sailors, right? He's like, "Listen, just throw me off." And they're like, "Nope, not yet." And they're like in a rowing contest with God, right? My money's on God. He's going to win that one in the process. And finally, they get to the realization they can't win this. So they cry out in verse 14. Then they cried out to the Lord, "Please, Lord, do not let us die for taking this man's life. Do not hold us accountable for killing an innocent man. For you, Lord, have done as you have pleased." They're acknowledging, they're going, "Listen, this storm is from you. We know that. We tried to row out of it. We can't beat you. We get it. You're in control. Please don't kill us for killing him." Why did Jonah say, "Throw me off the boat"? I think it's like those moments when you're on a tie tower or in like over water or jumping into a river and you're looking at it and you're like, "That's not gonna happen. Like, I'm not jumping." Jonah knew that. He's standing on the other boat going, "Nope, I ain't doing that. You're gonna have to throw me." And we see it takes place in verse 15. Then they took Jonah and threw him overboard. Now, I love stuff like this when I get in the story. I have to get in the story. What did that look like? Have you ever thought about that? Was that like, "Hey, you get his arms, I get his legs. Come on, let's go. One for the money, two for the show, three." Like, how did that happen? Did he fight? I mean, I probably would have been kicking and wiggling a little bit. I don't know. This is just how my mind works. It's crazy, I know. Verse 16. At this, the men greatly feared the Lord. Let me go back to 15. Then they took Jonah and threw him overboard, and the raging sea grew calm. At this, the men greatly feared the Lord, and they offered a sacrifice to the Lord and made vows to him. Imagine this moment. So they grab him. I don't know how it looks. They throw him overboard. As soon as he hits the water, calm. As flat as a mirror. Everything stops immediately. And look at the beauty of God's mercy. Do not miss this. God, in his love, took the disobedience of Jonah. What he intended for evil, God used for good, and we see these pagan soldiers give a sacrifice and believe in the Lord because of what they saw. God used his disobedience for somebody else's salvation. God wants you to see this as the mercy of God. He is love. He is constantly extending his mercy to those who receive it and believe. Beautiful thing to see that he uses it. And we're going to keep reading the story and see the beauty of the nature of God to use his obedience as well, reluctantly, to save as well. But God never wastes an opportunity to extend mercy to his children. If I was Jonah in this moment, As soon as he hit the water, it came calm like he said he would, like he said it would. If I was him in that moment, when I hit the water, I'm like, all right, we're good. Let me back up. Hey, come on, get me in the boat. That's what I would do. But we see that wasn't necessary in verse 17. Now the Lord provided a huge fish to swallow Jonah. We'll get back to that next week. Let's close with a few thoughts. Because of Jonah's unconfessed sin, it cost him. We see that throughout this portion of the story. Let me highlight four ways that Jonah lost something because of the cost of an unconfessed sin. The first was Jonah lost the voice of God. Notice that the narrative begins with God calling out to him as a prophet saying, go to Nineveh. But what eventually had to get everybody's attention was a storm, not God's word. He had to use his creation. See, Jonah lost the voice of God. Jonah lost his spiritual energy. He's sleeping while the world needs him around him. His spiritual fervor to serve the Lord, to serve people around him, to love, to be extension of mercy for those around him was lost because he was caught in his sin. Jonah lost his power in prayer. Notice when the sailors are like, everybody cry out to your God. They wake up Jonah like, cry out to your God. Jonah never did. He said, no, just throw me overboard. He lost the power of that voice of prayer with God because there was unconfessed sin that was in the middle. And last, Jonah lost his testimony. It should have been Jonah. His testimony, teaching who God is, that would result in these pagan sailors' salvation. But he lost his testimony. Instead, God had to use his creation in other ways. Beautiful thing. But unconfessed sin in our life has a way of bringing us down and down and down. And the reality of this first part of Jonah is we see again, you can't outrun your sin, but the beautiful nature of that is you can't outrun God either. That wherever you're running towards, you're going to run smack dab right back into him. I love how Pastor David Platt says it. He says this, God loves us too much to allow us just to stay in sin. If you go on sinning and the Lord doesn't bring conviction and confrontation, you need to reconsider your relationship with God. If you go on sinning and there is nothing in your heart that is pulling you away from it, you should fear for your soul. Many people are offended when God points out their sin. God is a God of love, they think. So he will just overlook my sin. But the reality is the reason God doesn't just overlook our sin is because he loves us. He loves us too much to leave us in sin. He wants more for us. God will never let his children sin successfully because he loves us. So where is that true in your life? Where is there unconfessed sin that's costing you greatly and you've lost things because of it? The beautiful invitation of God is that he sent his son Jesus Christ to die on the cross for those sins, that if we confess with our mouth that he is Christ and that Christ is Lord and believe in our hearts that he was resurrected from the grave, that we'll be saved and we can trust him for the forgiveness of our sins, can keep confessing those sins, laying it down before him, and he will save us from it. So I was going to close this service with a moment of just let's stand and worship, and it's going to be, oh, come to the altar and let's all come front and let's confess our sins. And I was like, man, let's do it a different way. Let's go to the beauty of the fact that you can't outrun your sin, but you can't outrun God either. And so here's the reality. We're going to stand and we're going to sing an old hymn that I love. Is it called It Is Well? I don't know what it's called. I think it's called It Is Well. I know we sing that. I love it. And here's what we're going to do. Let your confession be this very moment. The Holy Spirit has spoken to you. You know what it is. If there's an unconfessed sin that's unaddressed, you can stand right now. And as you stand, whisper it to him. Don't say it out loud. That might be awkward. Just whisper to him. He knows what it is. And stand with me. And then what we're going to do is we're going to sing the song, It Is Well, because the fact is on the altar of Jesus Christ, it is well and it is forgiven. So would you stand with me and let's engage in worship.
Like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sleeping
So Father, may that be true for every single one of us in this room, that we are built upon the foundation of Jesus Christ and the forgiveness of our sins in you alone, Jesus. And that is built on the truth that the tomb is empty, that you resurrected, that you walked this earth, that you ascended to heaven, you sent your Holy Spirit to be within us, to lead us, to guide us. Holy Spirit, today you've pointed where there's unconfessed sin that needs to be confessed. Our hearts have acknowledged. Give us the power that only you can give to turn from it, to repent, to chase after you, and to walk in step with you in our obedience, but even just above obedience, just to be in your presence and to be known as your children. We thank you for that. So have your way in our hearts this week, today, in our families, in our workplace, in our neighborhoods, in our classrooms, on the ball fields, wherever we're at, Father. Lead us and teach us how to better love you and to be an extension of mercy to those around us for the sake of Jesus Christ. We thank you for that. And it's in your holy name we pray, Jesus. And everybody said, amen. Well, church, we pray that it is well. If it is not, do not leave. Do not leave this room without resolving inside of your heart who Jesus Christ is and what he has done for you. If you need help with that or a conversation or prayer, we have pastors down front. I'll be down front myself. You can come talk. We'll pray through it, have more conversation, but don't leave without resolving that. I pray that you have a great week walking with the Lord. May we love God and
love others.
Can't wait to see you next week.